Good morning, and welcome to the fellowship of those who gather, whether here or virtually, to worship God. I am Pastor Deb Jarvis from West Bikun Prairie and Vong Churches, and I am delighted that you are here, either on the lawn or in your home. It is so good to be together. I have three announcements of joy to carry in our prayers. Yesterday, I had the honor of baptizing Lena Marie Swigum. She is the daughter of Kyle and Megan Swigum. And later today, I will baptize Kyra Sue Strand, the daughter of Quentin and Keely Strand. And then a little bit later, Maverick Cody Murphy, the son of Cody and Brooke Murphy. So it is delightful to have those opportunities, and I look forward to the time when these families that I have worshiped with at their homes can come to church and we can celebrate these new members. But for now, please hold these families and these youngsters in your prayers. Today we will be taking communion as usual. It will be available here on the lawn as well. If you wish to participate at home, please have a cracker or a piece of bread and some juice or wine available to participate. And now, blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble. Cast away our transgressions and turn us again to life in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. God hears the cries of all who cry out in need. And through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. We will now hear our gathering song, A Mighty Fortress.
The flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing, doth ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is he. The Lord of hosts is named from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed His truth to triumph through us. The Prince of Darkness grim, we tremble not for Him. His rage we can endure, for though His doom is sure, one little word shall fell Him. A mighty fortress, a rock unfailing, the King of glory forever. Amen. The word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gift are ours, though Him who with us sideth. Let good and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill. God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Is forever, forever. A mighty fortress, a rock unfailing, the King of glory forever. Amen.
Hear these words of greeting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, your servants. Because we cannot rely on our own abilities, grant us your merciful judgment, and train us to embody the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. This morning's first lesson comes from Psalm 145, 1 through 8. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our gospel acclamation. Alleluia. Open your hearts, O Lord, to give heed to what is said by your Son. Alleluia. The gospel reading continues as we have in the last few weeks, Matthew chapter 20, 1 through 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" And they said to him, "Because no one has hired us." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they'd receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landlord owner, saying, "Those last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Do you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, we've been journeying together through the Gospel of Matthew for several weeks. So at one level, I suppose we shouldn't be scandalized by this morning's passage. I mean, it seems that the Gospel of Jesus as told by Matthew shocks us fairly often. But I do believe this one is particularly hard to get one's head around. When you think about it, is it any wonder that the people who've worked all day are surprised and angered by the landowner's decision to pay the guys who didn't work the whole day exactly the same wages they got? Our innate sense of justice and just plain fairness is offended. We can't help but wonder, why would anyone work a whole day then? If they can get the same pay by only working a short time, wouldn't such a policy just cause laziness and cheating? It just doesn't seem like a very wise or prudent business plan. But we've been listening to Matthew long enough in the last weeks to realize we need to pause our worldview judgment and listen more deeply. Ponder what might be behind these startling words in Jesus' parable. It's worth the effort, because the ultimate message, although scandalous sounding at first, is a message of an immeasurable gift for each and every one of us. So let's ask some questions. First question, who are the last laborers and why are they last? A colleague of mine told me a story recently that might shed some light on that. She was telling about the city where her mother lives. It seems there's an intersection in town where there is a daily gathering of people who are hoping to be hired for work. Contractors, homeowners, those looking for seasonal help stop by to hire someone just for the day. By afternoon, there's still a few left on the corner. Who are they, and why are they there? The answer is that the young and strong and fit folk are hired first. Those who remain there are handicapped and elderly. But of course, they need housing and food, the basics of life, every bit as much as those who are more physically fit. Turns out they're not lazy, nor are they trying to get an easy wage. They want work. They just can't do it the same way as those who were first hired. We don't know, but perhaps it was something like that for the laborers that Jesus talks about in this story. Another question. Why is it that the laborers, and you and I, are so offended by the landowner's decision to give all the laborers, regardless of how long they worked, that same pay? What is it that makes us angry? The landowner's response is that he isn't cheating them. He's indeed paying them the wage that they all agreed upon. He isn't taking from their wage to pay those hired later. Yet, there is in us a sense that if a person's worked hard all day, that person should receive more pay than the ones who work for such a short time. A third question. Where do you fit in this story? Are you the first to be hired or the last? Those of us, and I'm going to guess that's most of us, who know ourselves to be first, just seem to inevitably believe we somehow are better. Perhaps we're more skilled. We've had better education. We've had more experience. We're more deserving. In other words, we feel that when we're first, we're entitled to a certain guaranteed set of privileges. Perhaps this is why the laborers are so outraged. They felt they were better and more deserving. And then the last. How do we understand the landowner's response? Does it take us aback a bit when he says, "Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" How do we logically balance the understanding that the landowner chooses to distribute what he said he would against our innate sense of fairness? Now let's look back at those four questions and ponder how they challenge us as followers of Jesus as we apply the queries to our world today. So, who are the last in line today? The answers are numerous. Here are a few that came to my mind. Likely you could add to the list. Those who are caught at the bottom of the disproportionate distribution of wealth. Those who live in a food desert where affordable and wholesome food is not available. Those who do not have an equal access to adequate housing. Those who do not have the opportunity for quality education. Those who cannot afford even the most basic of health care. Those who are rejected because of the color of their skin, the country they came from, or who they love. When we stop to consider the list, it doesn't take long before we realize that there are many in our own country who are indeed among the last. Next, why are we so offended by the landlord's decision? Clearly, we have an attitude based on a sense of fairness. We want credit for what we do. When we've worked our tail off, it feels like we should get recognition for what we've done. And in this instance, it seems that recognition is pay. The guy who only worked a few hours should be paid accordingly. It's only fair, is likely our typical cry. And then that third question. With whom do you relate in this story? Are you the person who doles out the paychecks at the end of the day? Are you the person who worked hard day after day and expects to be paid accordingly? Or are you the one who's out of work, or is underpaid, or feels cheated? What is our basic sense of personal privilege? That which we should have because of who we are, or what have we done? And finally, and this is where the human worldly perspective runs smack dab into the meaning Jesus would have us hear. The landowner's response is a metaphor for God's response. God's response to those questions that we, I hope, all be pondering this week. Just like the landowner, God promises to be just and is just. No one gets less than agreed upon. In addition, like the landowner, God is free to exceed what is just by worldly standards and can elect to act out of sheer generosity. Jesus tells us that to take offense at God's immense liberality, to be offended by God's incredible goodness, or to question God's amazing graciousness is to look at it with an evil eye or out of envy. God's love for and generosity toward each and every one of us, every single one of us, is the same. We call it grace. It's pure grace. We cannot earn it. We cannot control it, not for ourselves, let alone for someone else. God's amazing grace, as the song calls it, cannot be turned into a rating system. Ultimately, the parable of the laborers forces us to think about salvation in a way that bursts apart the framework of work and wages. Eternal life is a gift from God, not a claim on God. This charming but challenging tale invites us to recognize that God's grace is nothing less than a scandalous gift given to every single one of us. Amen. The song of the day, above all.
Check, check, check. Make sure it's on.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall. Thought of me above all. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you live rejected and alone like a rose, trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone like a rose, trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all.
Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Generous God, you make the last first and the first last. Where this gospel challenges the church, equip it for works of service. Strengthen those who suffer for Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sun and wind, bushes and worms, cattle and great cities, nothing in creation is outside your concern, mighty God. In your mercy, tend to it all. Give us a spirit of generosity toward all you have made. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Where we find envy and create enemies, you provide enough for all. Bring peace to places of conflict and violence. Inspire leaders with creativity and wisdom. Bless the work of negotiators, peace workers, and development workers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Reveal yourself to all in need as you are gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, ready to relent from punishing. Accompany judges and lawyers, victims of crime and those serving sentences. Give fruitful labor and a livelihood to those seeking work. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Even beyond our expectations, you choose to give generously. Grant life, health, and courage to all who are in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We praise for you the generations that have declared your power to us. Give us faithfulness to follow them, living for Christ, until you call us to join them in the joyful song around his throne. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things, and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always, and also with you. It is at this time that we give you thanks for your gifts. We praise you and celebrate every penny that you are able to give to us as we continue our ministry on behalf of both congregations. There is much to do and much being done. It's harder to see it now that we're isolated by COVID. But please take my word for it. Good work is being done, and we do so appreciate the gifts that you can give us. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. You have set before us these gifts of your good creation. Prepare us for your heavenly banquet. Nourish us with this rich food and drink, and send us forth to set tables in the midst of a suffering world. Through the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. We know that on the night that our Lord was betrayed, he gathered with his friends in the upper room, and after dinner, he took bread, which you have in your little cup, and broke it after giving thanks, and shared it with his friends, saying, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat, and do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup, and again after giving thanks, he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood given for you. Take and drink, and do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray. O Holy One, we pray that you will bless these simple elements, that we may know in our own very beings the presence of your gifts for our own salvation. Hear this, our prayer, and all our prayers, in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Come to the banquet table, where Christ gives himself as food and drink. The body of Christ given for you, take and eat. The blood of Christ poured out for you, take and drink. We give thanks, gracious God, that you have once again fed us with food beyond compare, the body and the blood of Christ. Lead us from this place, nourished and forgiven, into your beloved vineyard, to wipe away the tears of all who hunger and thirst, guided by the example of the same Jesus Christ, and led by the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. And for our children who are here, blessings from God our Father, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And for all of us, Mother and God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and lead you into the way of life and truth. Amen. Our sending song, "How Great is Our God."
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all we see, how great is our God? Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all we see, how great, how great is our God? Name above all names, worthy of all praise, my heart will sing, how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise, my heart will sing, how great is our God. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all we see, how great is our God.
Go now in peace. Remember the poor. Thanks be to God.